Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to our service again. As always, some intimations. First of all, we have to intimate it for two Sundays, so it's going to be this Sunday and next Sunday, that all the congregations in Murray Presbytery have been cited to attend the Presbytery of the 6th of September at 7 o'clock in Bucky North. Now, this is, of course, where the presbytery plan, you know, I've been talking about the presbytery draft plan, is going to be discussed, and all the amendments from the various congregations and ministers are going to be presented and voted on. Now, only members of presbytery are allowed to vote, but all congregations are being cited to attend for their information. So, we are expected to send 5 people from each congregation, including presbytery elders. So that means that there is space, and it's not prescriptive, so we can be more than 5. So if you all are wondering what to do with yourselves on a Tuesday evening, especially on the 6th of September, why not come along and come have a listen? I kind of promise it will be worth your while, but it's something to do. So, if you want to come, please do feel free to do so. I would appreciate it though if you could give me, just let me know if you're coming so that we can just check our numbers. If we're more than 5, we're more than 5, but we want to try to be at least 5 people. Now, I said previously, this is the last time, it's a friendly invite. The next one I'm going to start pointing my fingers. Good, so that's just for your information. We've also put it up in the vestibule, so as you come into the church, it's also there on the notice board if you wanted to have a look at the citation. Now, this evening at 6:30 p.m., the gathering will be having another box and blether. Now, those of you who helped us last time knew it was good fun, sorting through all our donations for Global Aid Network and putting it all in boxes. So if you want to come and help us again tonight, that's 6:30 at the Dufton Community Centre. And as always, join us for a cup of coffee or tea after the service. Let us now call our attention to our worship this morning. Gathered or scattered, on site or online, faithful or faltering, the door is open and God bids us come. Here there is food for body and soul, bread of heaven and wine of salvation. The word is heard, prayers are offered, and songs of praise. God is the host, and all are welcome. Let us worship. Amen. Let us sing hymn 133, Source and Sovereign, Rock and Cloud.
Thank you.
Now, this morning, we're going to be talking about table manners. Now, since we don't have young folk joining us this morning, I'm going to ask the even younger folk if they can tell us a bit about table manners. What is one thing that you can't stand somebody doing at a table? Oh, goodness me, there's a lot of things. What? Try again. Phones. Okay, so phones at a table. That's an interesting 21st century problem, isn't it? Because you didn't have phones at the tables long, long ago. Well, it's not. It's just even in the last few decades, I would say, that it's become a problem. Anything else you can't stand at a table?
Talking with a mouthful.
Talking with a mouthful. I myself have a wife who gets physically ill if she can hear someone chew. So I understand that. Yes, anything else? What's something that's rude in our culture to do at a table?
Elbows on tables or licking your knife.
Oh yes, elbows on tables or licking your knife. That's not the kind of behavior that we do at tables. Now, I've done some research as to strange table manners from around the world. Interestingly, well, let me do it in the form of a question. If you were eating fish that had bones in it, and you were eating the top part of the fish, what would you do after you've reached the bones? Would you flip it over? If it's a kind of flat fish with bones in the middle, running through the middle. Now, whether you do that or not, in China, it's very rude to flip over a fish in your plate, because it is seen as a wish for the fisherman that caught that fish's boat to flip over, apparently. So in Japan, you don't pass things from one pair of chopsticks to another. So if you pick up something with your chopsticks, you can't hand it to someone else to take with their chopsticks. That is considered very, very rude. Now, in India, you don't eat with your left hand. Because people in India mostly eat with their hands, you eat with your right hand, and then only the fingertips. Now, I think most of you knew this. But if you were to have guests over for coffee, would you pour them a full cup or a half cup? Depends on who it is. But let's assume you wanted them to stay a while. What would you do? Would you give them a full cup or a half cup? Full cup. So in Saudi Arabia and the Emirati cultures, when you give someone a full cup, that means please drink and leave. If you give someone half a cup, it means please stay a while. And if you're finished with your cup of coffee and you don't want any more coffee, you have to shake your cup to show that you're done. So remember that when you go to Saudi Arabia. I think someone said chewing with an open mouth or something like that is rude in our culture. So what do we think about slurping? Yes, no. I can see on some faces it's a pet peeve, isn't it? Someone's slurping at their soup or their coffee or something. Now, interestingly, in Japan, slurping is encouraged because that's sign of enjoyment. In Ethiopia, you use a communal plate. So there's one big plate on the table with loads of different types of food, and everybody shares in the same plate. You also eat with your hands, but you're only allowed to eat what's in front of you. So it's the luck of the draw on which side of the table you sit. I don't know if they rotate the plate, I would assume so. And then you can have something else, but you're only supposed to eat from the section that's right in front of you. Now, in Korea, they have an interesting thing that they do. So the elders would sit at the end of the table, and all the dishes would be put before them, and then they would decide what to send down the table to be eaten. And you're not to refuse anything being sent down by your elders down the table to eat. In South Africa, certain traditional African cultures eat also with their hands, but you are not supposed to have your feet pointed towards anyone else or the food. I don't think that's very good for your back. And it's also, and you might have seen this on TV, if you've ever seen it in traditional African cultures, especially in South Africa, if you greet someone or you hand them something, especially at the table, with your right hand, you don't do it with your left hand, and you touch your arm like this as a sign of respect. So often when you greet someone, you would also put your hand on your arm as a sign of respect. Now for us, this might be strange, some of these cultural things that happen in other countries and in other cultures at the table. And today we'll be speaking about Jesus's strange table manners. And when we speak about what Jesus did when he was at the table with the Pharisees, he went to have dinner with a Pharisee, we should always remember that Jesus always seemed to upset the apple cart when it came to meals. He wasn't an ideal guest, it seems, to have at your dinners, because he would always cause an upset of some sort. But we'll get to that in a bit. Before we do that, let us sing hymn 115. In song, in word, and in silence. May we remain humble and faithful to you here and now and always. We come to show our love for you and all you have revealed to us in Jesus. We come to hear your word afresh and learn more of you. We come to offer ourselves just as we are and to give our gifts to help build your kingdom. Lord, we also come to confess our faults and failings. You know the poor choices we have made, the pride we battle with daily, the ego that longs to rule our lives. We ask forgiveness, Lord, for mistakes and poor choices. Help us to receive your freely offered forgiveness and to recommit ourselves to making better choices and paying attention to your Spirit guiding us in our daily lives. Lord, we want to be the best we can and to live faithfully. May we draw strength and courage from you as we go about our daily lives. Let us draw strength and courage again this morning in praying the prayer your Son taught us, as it unites us in our reaching and waiting for your kingdom. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Our first reading this morning is Psalm 23. And Liz is going to be reading for us this morning. Thank you, Liz.
The Lord is my shepherd. I have everything I need. He lets me rest in fields of green grass and leads me to quiet pools of fresh water. He gives me new strength. He guides me in the right paths, as he has promised. Even if I go through the deepest darkness, I will not be afraid, Lord, for you are with me. Your shepherd's rod and staff protect me. You prepare a banquet for me where all my enemies can see me. You welcome me as an honoured guest and fill my cup to the brim. I know that your goodness and love will be with me all my life, and your house will be my home as long as I live.
Let us sing hymn 528.
Instead, when you are invited, Go and sit in the lowest place, so that your host will come to you and say, come on up, my friend, to a better place. This will bring you honour in the presence of all the other guests. For all those who make themselves great will be humbled, and those who humble themselves will be made great. Then Jesus said to his host, when you give a lunch or a dinner, do not invite your friends or your brothers or your relatives or your rich neighbours, for they will invite you back, and in this way you will be paid for what you did. When you give a feast, invite the poor, the crippled, the lame, and the blind, and you will be blessed, because they are not able to pay you back. God will repay you on the day that good people rise from death. May the Lord bless these readings of his holy word. Amen.
A few years ago, the church where I was one of the ministers had an outreach to Malawi. And we went to Malawi to help a small community outside Mkoma build and paint a small school for the children in that community. And it was hard work, and at the end of 3 weeks we were there, the minister of the local church there invited us all for dinner. But what was strange was that his invitation did not extend to all who had helped in those 3 weeks. It was just the ministers, their spouses, of which I did not have one at the time, the local missionary, and a few senior elders who were invited. It felt wrong, as the people who did most of the work were not invited to this special meal. But it should be noted, even the minister's own families and wives were not at the tables. They would only receive what was left over after we, the guests of honour, had had our full. Now, luckily, one serving of goat's meat and wild spinach was all I could manage. And I realised that the mostly European culture in which I grew up made this experience uncomfortable. It's a cultural aspect. It doesn't really have anything to do with religion or faith. It is a cultural thing. For the people who grew up in that part of Malawi, this was very normal. And not doing it that way would be seen as a slap in the face. But it was strange and uncomfortable to see others being excluded from the table due to their lack of titles or social standing. In our readings, Jesus is once again at a table, this time another table of a Pharisee. And it all becomes a bit awkward when Jesus criticizes the host and the guest's etiquette. Scrambling for the best place, of course, the place of honor being right next to the host. Jesus upsets the apple cart as he usually did, and I can imagine them being dumbfounded by Jesus' words. He tells them that they're going about it the wrong way. The places that they think are the places of honor are not. Then he goes on to say that they're supposed to invite all the unclean people from the street to the table. Oh, the scandal. These poor people were just sitting down to have a meal. They were just doing what was expected of them in the time and culture that they were living in. In fact, the Old Testament taught them how to act at a meal. They were taught to do this. They learned it from their parents, and their parents learned it from their parents. It's been taught through the generations. This is how you act at a dinner table in that time, in that culture. This is our tradition. This is our culture, they would have said. And if you want to upset people, go against their cultural norms. Jesus had this many times, but he never seemed to learn the lesson. Because every time Jesus sat down at the table, Usually chaos ensued for some reason. Culture is a very strange thing. It seems to find its way into everything, especially into religion. Many religions from all over the world are intertwined with the religions and the cultures from those countries. In fact, for centuries, Christian mission work was aimed at teaching other cultures to eat with knives and forks, to wear modest clothes, to speak European languages. Western culture has a lot to answer for, as a lot of colonial conquering was done under the guise of mission work. Mission work was seen as successful if the missionaries could eradicate local cultural customs they found uncomfortable or contradictory to their own Western ideals, and replace them with European etiquette. People were not so much expected to accept Jesus as their Lord rather than just be clothed properly, use cutlery. The traditional Americans lost their headdress, the Maori in New Zealand stopped tattooing their faces, the southern African tribes lost their loincloths. Because being Christian meant you ascribed, in that time, to certain cultural norms. Which is perhaps a little sad. And before we exclaim, thank goodness we don't do that anymore, we should have a good hard look at how church is done in our own context today and ask ourselves, are we doing what the church was meant for? Or is the church just another institution sustaining a culture? To ask it differently, what distinguishes our church from a cultural social club? Does what we do here live up to the great mission Jesus declared when he went up to heaven? Or do people sometimes use the church as the last bastion of European culture? We may have stopped seeing mission work as the enculturation of indigenous people. But I think sometimes, all over the world, in many aspects, the Christian church has pulled in. We've pulled inward. Our buildings, our way of doing things become an enclave for tradition and culture, rather than a living community meant to be a place of refuge for all in need. In need of love, acceptance, grace. Allow me to ask some questions out loud. Questions I keep asking myself while doing my work as a minister. Questions that I don't think I have the answers to. Questions I'm sometimes afraid to ask myself. Uncomfortable questions. Does what I and we do here include or exclude people? Do visitors find this place welcoming? Do they find it an easy place to be, or are they expected to fumble through an awkward hour where they have no idea what's happening, or what the words we use mean? Or watch us saying the Lord's Prayer, wishing they knew the words. The last and most uncomfortable question I have to ask myself regularly is, do we keep doing this because it has become our culture and not because it has anything to do with our faith in Jesus and what he stood for? And I feel very conflicted when I ask these questions, especially I don't like it. I can ask them for myself, but I don't like other people asking me these questions. Because this is how I grew up. This is the space within which I feel safe. I know how to be here. I know how to act. I know what is expected of me. I have come to learn how to worship in this way, and I find comfort in it. Surely there can't be anything wrong with that. Why mess with it? In Afrikaans, we have an expression that translates as, why scratch where there is no itch? And then I realized that from the very start of the Christian faith, while Jesus was still traveling from town to town with his disciples, almost every meal he had was shrouded in controversy. Because he challenged people to not let their culture become their religion. If their cultural practices caused them to exclude, discriminate, and make others feel unwelcome, then they were worshipping their culture and not God. Jesus caused many meals to come to a screeching halt. When he didn't wash his hands, when he invited prostitutes to the table, when he allowed a woman to caress his feet with her hair at the table, when he had dinner with a tax collector, or when he stopped at a dinner party just to heal a sick person. All cultural taboos in that time. I don't think, knowing what I've read about Jesus, if he were alive on the earth today, walking around as you and I, if I would invite him to a dinner party at the Mass. I don't think I would. I think we always say nice things like, oh, if Jesus were alive, he were here on earth, I would invite him, I would ask him all kinds of questions. I'm not sure I would, because I wouldn't want to have him as a dinner guest, with all respect. I'm afraid he might ask me why certain people were not invited. I would be afraid to invite him because he might ask me what I love more, him or the way I've always done things. David declared that the Lord is his shepherd, that the Lord makes him to sit at the banquet. As a guest of honor. But David didn't say this in a sense like he deserved it. It was grace. He meant he'd never deserved to be at the table, and still he was invited. No, he wasn't invited, he was made to sit at that table. His head anointed with oil. Jesus came to tell us and his followers in the gospel that we just read that we should not expect to sit alone at that table. That the table should be made bigger and broader. The invitation should be sent out wider. That we can't worship culture or tradition, but we can and should worship God. And be prepared to have people around his table that have awkward table manners. And we should make them feel just as welcome. The world is filled to the brim with people who need to know they are accepted, that they are loved, that they are forgiven. There are so many people who need to be at the Lord's table where his unconditional love is celebrated. And when our guest list for this special meal is limited by things that are dictated by culture and tradition, may Jesus disrupt our meal too. Until we can make a bigger table where all are welcome. The last few weeks' reading from the lectionary have been challenging. And I think most of us don't like being challenged. Who does? All the readings in the last few weeks have challenged me from all sides. From our readings and sermon and by the bigger church structures as we go through this planning process, where church buildings are being closed, ministers are being moved around. Personally, I'm anxious about being given extra responsibility. The prospect of having to minister another church is daunting to me. For some churches, this prospect of closing their buildings and going elsewhere is heart-wrenching. But at the heart of all of this is perhaps the greatest challenge of all. Having to look in the mirror held up by Jesus and asking difficult questions about whether God and his kingdom is still our reason for being here, or if we are here to maintain buildings and maintain cultural traditions, rather than be a safe place for all those in need. It's not all gloom and difficult questions, though. I think we can all agree here in our community and in our church, we do much for others. We try to be as inviting and open to strangers as we can. The challenge is to ask ourselves, where can we improve? What do we still cling to? Culture is wonderful and culture should be celebrated. But may it never stand in our way of having more people around the table. I want to end with a story most of you might have heard before. As the story goes, Queen Victoria was hosting a guest from a foreign country. And at the end of the meal, finger bowls of water were passed around so that everyone could clean their hands. The guest of honour had never seen such a thing. So he lifted the finger bowl to his mouth and started drinking. Stunned silence passed through the room until the Queen raised her finger bowl to her mouth and drank also. And all the guests followed suit. Do we expect others to conform to our norms, to share this space with us? Or are we prepared to lift the finger bowls to our mouths in order to make it a more welcoming place for others, however awkward it may feel? Just listen to our voluntary as we reflect on our readings. Loving God, In your upside-down kingdom, the last shall be first, and there will be endless justice and peace. Oh, how we wish that kingdom was here and now. We regret that our ancestors did not learn from the humility of Jesus, nor did they build the kingdom upside down as you desired. Because we still live in a world dominated by the rich, and the poor are given no place of honour, let alone what they need to survive each day. Lord, we long for your kingdom to come, for the poor to be offered decent pay for their work, for the ability of each person to provide for loved ones, for homes that people can afford to live in and pay their bills. Lord, we long for your kingdom to come, for the rich to realize and see their neighbors in distress and choose to help instead of eyeing up their profit margins. Lord, we long for your kingdom to come, for everyone to be invited to the table which has no special seats and where everyone is treated equally. Lord, we long for your kingdom to come, for people who hold power to use it for the good of all, rather than for the good of the few, and to plan for long-term solutions to climate, immigration, and welfare problems. Lord, we long for your kingdom to come, for the day when love wins and humanity lets go of fear and hate to enable all people to live in harmony. Lord, help us to continue to work to build your kingdom here and now, to use our gifts locally and globally in whatever way we can, so that your will is done. Help us make our tables longer instead of shortening our guest lists. Let us not worship our own cultural norms, Lord, but let us worship you. Holy Spirit, help us to make it so, in Jesus' name. Amen. Let us sing hymn 251.
Thank you.
Be with you and remain with you this day and forevermore.